step by. Come sit down beside me and hear my sad story. I'm shot in the breast and I know I must die. Get six jolly cowboys to carry my coffin. Six pretty maidens to carry my pall. Get bunches of roses to throw on my coffin. Roses to soften the clods as they fall. Oh, beat the drum slowly and play the fife lowly. Play the dead march as they carry me along. Take me to the green valley and lay the sod o'er me. For I am a young cowboy and I know I've done wrong.
You! No, Carter! You.
That's right, you lily-livered, yellow-bellied, crawling skunk. It's me, and I've come to get you, Joe. Now draw.
Wait a minute, Rackham.
I'm gonna count to three, Joe.
Gee, Rackham, I didn't know you could count that high.
I don't think that's funny. One! Two!
See?
Thank you. heart of the purest 18-karat gold. And God has not forgotten Gopher Gulch, folks, though at times it may appear that he has temporarily overlooked it. We have our town parson, the Reverend Stan Lee Blackwood.
Problem. for the Chamber of Commerce, and speaking for the Chamber of Commerce...
Gentlemen, it is a problem for God. We are agreed that all human expedients are powerless. But pause and consider. Man is mortal. Sneaky Fitch surely cannot live forever. One day, he must die.
Yeah, but if only we can help him... Help him along a little.
It's tempting thought, brother, I must confess. But let us, rather, repose our trust in divine providence.
And the liquor, the red sneaky puts it away. I can't see how he's lasted this long.
Yeah, I think he's going to live in just out of sheer cussedness.
Well, he's ornery, all right, and sneaky.
Sneaky Fitch. Sneaky Fitch is a low-down yellow son of a...
Drunk again, Brother Fitch?
Again, Reverend? Hell no! The word is still.
notable man.
Well, howdy, Doc. The house seems down at the old little factory.
You might stand a downwind to be sneaky.
And you, Undertaker, still hanging around here looking for business, eh? Well, I ain't no prospective customer. Not yet, anyway, so just move along.
Yeah, well, you would be, King, if you was half a man.
Draw, sneaky bitch. No thanks. No
thanks. You can't say no thanks. I'm challenging you. Don't you get it? Any man with a drop of courage or honor, now he's got to draw when he's challenged. Yeah. Why, it's the code of the West.
Well, I'm an Easterner.
Oh.
We're not here 50 years ago from New Jersey, and I ain't drawn.
I can't stand it. I can't stand to see the code of the West trampled on and desecrated by a...
Easterner. Oh. Dagnabbit, Rackham, don't get all tore up and take the blubbering again. Try to look at it my way. Now, every day you challenge me to a draw. And every day you say I ain't a going to. I mean, why should I? For one thing, this old gun of mine ain't worth a tinker's damage. For another thing, you're a lot younger and faster on a draw than me. So for me to draw on you, it'd be just plain suicide. And who wants to go around committing suicide? It's ridiculous. Besides, if I didn't want to commit suicide, I can think of more painless ways of doing it.
And like drinking yourself to death?
Well, I had considered that possibility.
All right, sneaky bitch, you low-down, yellow-bellied, crawling skunk. You won't fight. Maybe I could get a little entertainment out of you. What do you say, boy?
Yeah.
Shall we have a little fun?
I shall.
You can't draw, sneaky.
Oh, no, no.
Maybe you can dance.
No.
Sounds too good to be true.
Hey, Doc, maybe if you just kind of take
Bucky. Come on.
Thank you.
But I don't want to die. I don't want to give in to it. I want to stay alive. That's what my whole life's been devoted to, you might say. Staying alive.
Well, I know, Sneaky. There's a lot of folks in town that kind of hold that against you.
What? Why, staying alive? Why, what's wrong with that?
Well, Sneaky, a lot of folks figure a man of real honor and courage shouldn't be so particular about staying alive. And with that coming, it just ain't honorable.
Well, all these people that say all them things, now they're all pretty much alive, ain't they?
Now, Sneaky, I didn't come out here to argue with you. I came out to see what I could do to help you along. Burr, it's cold in here.
Yeah, just get a mite breezy on a windy day.
Why, you ought to light a fire.
No!
Why?
Well, that stove don't cross a good dock, and it gets all smoky in here. Besides, I'm fine. Long as I stay in bed with these covers up over me.
All right, if you say so.
Doc, I got a request to make you. A last request.
What is it?
Well, being as how there ain't nobody else, and you're the only friend they got in the world, it's about my funeral arrangements, Doc. Now, first off, I want to be buried I want you to get me one of them $50 coffins. I don't want none of them cut-rate boxes of Urban Vales.
$50?
And then, on my headstone, I want you to put, here lies Franklin Fitch.
Franklin?
Yeah.
Franklin?
Yeah, well, that's my real name, Doc. I never really used it because, somehow everybody just took to calling me Sneaky. I mean, I never really mind too much, but, I figure now that I'm dead or almost dead, I don't see why I couldn't have a little more dignity.
Well, all right, Franklin Fitch. I got it, Sneaky. I can't bring myself to call you anything but Sneaky. It just don't seem right.
Doc, you don't gotta call me Franklin. Just my gravestone.
Well, all right, if you say so.
And then under that, you should put the years of my birth and my death. But I can't rightly recall when I was born. So just put, he was born and he died.
He was born and he died.
And then under that put, he was a good man.
He was a good? I can't put that.
Why not?
Because you weren't a good man.
Well, I weren't a bad one.
Well, no, not bad like murderers and outlaws and such, but dang, damn it, Sneaky, you were a coward. Well, you drank and you cussed and, hell, man, you were dang near a sinner.
Well, all right, then put, he was as good as most and better than some. Now that's all right, ain't it?
Well, I suppose so. I suppose you can say that about almost anyone.
And Doc, don't forget to lay me out in my burying suit there.
I'll see to that as soon as I get back. Listen, I gotta be getting back to town, and I'll see to all these arrangements as soon as I get back there.
Well, now, wait a minute. You ain't just gonna leave me alone here to die, are you?
Well, now, Sneaky, I got other patients to attend to, you know. Patients that got a chance. Well, I'll tell you what, though. I'll leave you a little bottle of medicine.
Will it cure me?
Well, now, Sneaky, I told you, for what you got, there practically ain't no cure. But I'll tell you one thing, though. If anything can do it, this stuff can. This stuff can practically make the dead think up their beds and walk.
Is that right?
Well, of course, I never tried on anybody as far gone as you before, but, well, even if it don't cure you, it'll make you feel kind of drowsy, so you can walk peaceful-like instead of fighting it.
Oh, I don't know, Doc. I think I'd just as soon fight it. I mean, I've been fighting it all my life, and now don't seem no time to stop.
Well, you're a little out of your head right now, and that's why you're talking that way. Now, you just have a few sips and lie down and rest. I'll call Burton Bale to come by in the morning with his wagon. You ought to be all stiffened up and ready by then. Drink up now. Come on, drink up.
How does it taste, Doc? Nasty?
Well, of course it tastes nasty. It's medicine, ain't it? You know anything that's good for you is unpleasant. You know that. Now, come on, drink up.
Yeah, that's true. All right. Ugh! Ugh! Ugh!
My dear friends, let us commend our brother. Sneaky Fitch,
to the almighty fire which made him. Sneaky Fitch, our brother in Christ, we commit your body to the earth and your soul to heaven, where it will be judged before the eternal throne. Amen.
Amen.
Now, let me see here. I got it in here just somewhere. There. I have a D for you.
Shall we gather at the river where bright angel feet have trod, with its crystal tide forever flowing by the throne of God?
Yes, we shall gather at the river, the beautiful, the beautiful.
Thank you.
from all the Main Street merchants. Well, it's the same homey little town, as you can see. Nothing much ever changes in a place like Gopher Gulch during the old diurnal round of the sun, the moon, and the stars. Well, the setting, the characters, they stay pretty much the same, chapter after chapter, century after century, except for that one small exception. But that's what our story's about tonight, that one small exception to the universe. Yes, sir, in a Western myth, nothing ever changes, nothing can. It's against the rules, and when it does, all hell is liable to break loose.
Look how far you've fallen. You've drawn on an right. To a card game.
What?
A
card game?
Now look, Sneaky, I'm not gonna draw on you, because I know there ain't no man can kill you, so there ain't no point in me trying. But I just can't stand to see you romancing my girl no longer.
Yeah.
So I'm gonna play you a hand of poker for her. Five-card showdown. If I lose, I turn in my badge and my gun, and I'll get out of town.
Yeah.
But if you lose, you get out of town and leave room to me. Fair enough?
Yeah.
All right, why not? I ain't never turned down a hand of poker yet. There, bring out the chairs and the cards right out here so everybody can see them. Now, wait a minute, Sneaky.
I said, I old deal.
Sure, Franklin. Ready?
I'm ready.
Done about that man.
About what?
Our men folk are obviously scared silly of him.
Donald applied for that job.
Men folk ought to be ashamed of themselves.
Well, I say, if they won't take any action, we should.
For their sakes, hell.
Well, we could vamp him.
Mrs. Blackwood, what the heck do you mean?
To tell you the truth, I'm not quite sure. My husband says all we can do is pray.
He's a good man, your husband.
Oh, my, yes. And an excellent banker, too. Everybody says so.
Yes, indeed.
Well, I've got to be getting home, Mrs. Dale. Been a real comfort talking to you.
Likewise, I'm sure.
Thank you. Morning, Sheriff.
Morning, Mervin. Lady, gentlemen.
I've got the money right here, Sheriff, just as we agreed. Just a moment. Oh, Mr. Blackwood?
Yeah?
Mr. Blackwood, speaking to you now as the town's banker, and not as its religious representative, I have here the sum of $250 collected from these good citizens of Gopher Gulch to be offered as a reward for the capture, dead or alive, and preferably the former, of one Sneaky Fitch. We would like you to hold this money in trust until such time as Sheriff Rackham comes to collect it.
It's a pleasure, Mr. Bale.
Three cheers for our new sheriff!
Hip, hip, hooray! Hip, hip, hooray! Hip, hip, hooray!
Gosh, you're much obliged, folks.
Well, now we'll see some action. I should think so. No one can outdraw Rackham. Cause no one can kill Sneaky Fitch, either. Well, we'll see, Mrs. Vale. We'll see.
So that was the setup for the great meeting between Sneaky Fitch, the man who had defeated death, and Rackham, the fastest gun in the West. The showdown. The classic moment of truth that is the climax of every Western myth. When two invincible men step into the main street at dusk, walk slowly toward one another, and draw. And of course, this showdown had all the ingredients and more, because what's going to happen when a man that nobody can outdraw meets a man that nobody can kill? I'll tell you. This is what happened. But before we go into that, in order to relieve a little of this tension, which is becoming darn near unbearable, I think it's time we had a little tune. Strong men step into the street, face one another, their hands poised, ready to draw. The moment of truth, the showdown.
Don't shoot me!
you're scared, Rackham.
I am scared. You're not scared, Sneaky, because you forgot what fear is all about. You're not afraid to die, but I am. I want to live.
In fact, you ain't nothing but a coward.
I'm a coward.
You are a disgrace to the Code of the West.
I am. I'm a disgrace to the Code. But I'm a lying disgrace. He can be pushing me.
I'll be. Come over here, Rackham. On your knees.
My boots are not dusty. Why don't you shine them up for me?
Thank you.
Rackham! Get out here! You sure? You didn't do a very good job on this here sidewalk.
Oh, no, Mr. Fitch, no.
Call.
pardon, Reverend, but there are codes and there are codes, and there's life and there's death, and this is a matter of life and death, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And the only question is, who's gonna do it?
It's a job for a man.
Oh, I should think so.
Well, I am a man of God, not of violence. I've never handled a gun in my life.
I'll do it.
You?
You, Miss Maroon, but I thought...
I hate him. Oh, sure. I used to like him. I used to sort of feel sorry for him. But no more. Besides, I figure I can get closer to him than anybody else.
But the danger, ma'am.
Oh, hell. All I've got to lose is my life, and that's not worth much. Besides, what else has anybody got to lose?
Yeah.
This is a brave thing you're doing, Miss Maroon.
When do you think you can do it?
The first chance I get. Maybe tonight.
The Lord be praised.
And Miss Maroon, too. Until tonight, then.
Night in the Old West comes with the perfume of the sagebrush and the distant howling of a coyote. The moon floats above, touching the silent prairie with silver. The air is still. Everything is still. Night in the Old West is a quiet time, a lonesome time. So lonesome I do cry.
Major. Oh, that you wrapped up yet? Where are you off to?
Back to that little shack out there, you know.
Look at that little shack on the edge of town.
That's around right.
Well, come on over here and sit down, Rackham.
What for?
No particular reason. I just want to talk to somebody. Anybody. You know, I've been watching you, Rackham.
You mean you're not satisfied with my work, Mr. Fitch?
No, nothing like that. I've been studying your face. You know, you look to me to be a happy man.
Well, I reckon I am ever since, well, you know, that day.
You mean that day I disgraced you in front of the whole town?
That's about right.
But I don't get it.
Well, I don't rightly get it either. You know, back there when I was a famous gunfighter and all, I was sort of tensed up and nervous all the time, you know? But now, I just sleep real good out in that little old shack.
You know, I used to sleep good out there, too. Back in my coward days. Back there when I used to go around full of the fear of death. Like you do now, I suppose.
Now that you mention it, I reckon I do. I'll wake up every morning scared to death that I'm going to die that day, from taking ill or being shot or something. And then, you know, I just kind of think that here I am and I'm alive for one more day. And it just kind of makes life worth living. Well, if there wasn't anything else you wanted, Sheriff, I'll just be getting along home.
Hmm? Oh, yeah. All right, driver. Good night.
Thanks, Sheriff.
I'm so lonesome, I could cry.
I really
you believe the head rose up from the dead just as much as you did. I weren't trying to fool nobody. I believed it myself.
You shot Jack Oglesby.
Yeah! Oh, no, no. No, that was a mistake. That was a mistake, and I'm real sorry about that.
You humiliated me in front of the whole town.
Yeah. Now, Rackham.
And you made me crawl in the dust and lick your boots.
Yeah, well, I've been meaning to have a little chat with you about that there.
Yeah, I tell you, the time for chatting's through. Now's the time for action.
Rackham, I thought you said you liked being the way you was.
Well, that's when I thought you was immortal. But now everything's the same as it was. You're nothing but Sneaky Fitch, the town tower.
Yeah!
Yeah!
Yeah! Yeah.
And I'm Rackham, the fastest gun in the West.
Yeah!
Sneaky Fitch, you've got a lot to answer for.
Now, wait a minute.
I'm asking you to draw, mister.
No. Just wait a minute, Rackham. Now, just wait now.
Are you going to draw, or am I going to shoot you where you stand?
You was the only man I ever loved, Sneaky. Oh. But I had to do it.
Got me. Come. Dead. Santa.
Sneaky, you better lie down, Sneaky.
No. It's all right, Doc. I'm fine.
Hey, Sneaky, you're a goner. This time, it's no joke.
I know it, Doc. I know it. And I'm happy.
Happy?
That's right. Because I just discovered something. Something great. You know, that time before, when I faced Rackham, and he was so afraid of me, I didn't feel nothing. I knew he couldn't shoot me, and I didn't have any fear in me. I was ice cold, like a machine, like I was dead. But this time, I was scared stiff. I could feel the warm blood running through my veins, and my knees was a-knocking, and my hands was a-sweating. I tell you, Doc, I was alive. I don't know but what I weren't more alive right then I've ever been before in my life.
You better not try to talk, Sneaky.
No, I want to talk. I want to talk. Because, like I say, I'm so blame happy. Just one thing that bothers me, though.
What's that, Sneaky?
I can't figure out which one's the real me. The coward or the gunfighter? Maybe neither one. Because it seems I never was myself, really. I always just seemed to be what other people seemed to think I was. If they thought I was a coward and treated me like one, well, then I was afraid, and I acted like one. But if they was afraid of me, and I was full of courage, and I didn't have no fear of nothing, you know what I think, Doc?
What's that?
Maybe there's a me inside that ain't even been discovered yet.
Maybe, Sneaky. Maybe.
Doc.
Yeah?
You remember before when we was talking about my gravestone?
I remember, Sneaky.
I've changed my mind about that inscription I want on it. I mean, now that it's for real and all, I want you to put Sneaky Fitch. He was born and he died. And never rightly knew who he was, but he died happy.
Well, that's kind of long for a gravestone, Sneaky.
It is? Yeah, I guess you're right. Well, I just put Sneaky Fitch? ? That ought to about sum it up.
Yeah, I reckon it should, Sneaky. I reckon it should.
Bye, Doc. It's been quite a life.